Hi guys, good morning. Today the chapter which we are going to discuss is the theory of demand. So you must remember that what is the meaning of the term demand? Demand literally means the want for anything or the desire for anything. Now, literally you must remember that mere wish for having a particular commodity cannot be said to be demand in economics. In economics, demand for anything is the amount of it that will be bought per unit of time at a given price. Now you must remember here that in economics, demand refers to an effective desire. Effective desire here means a desire which is backed by, number one, willingness to buy a commodity, and number two is backed by purchasing power. Now suppose you visit a shopping mall and you see that a mobile phone, Apple iPhone, is there in the stores, and you wish to have a mobile phone. But having a desire for purchasing a mobile set which is very precious to you, but if you don't have the necessary means, that is the money to have the same, in that case, it cannot be said to be an effective desire. That means, to have that particular commodity, it must be backed by the purchasing power. That is, the ability to pay the price. That means, number one, you must have the willingness to buy a commodity. And secondly, it must be backed by the purchasing power. That is, the necessary means to have the same, that is the price that is to be paid for the said product, must be there, then only you can say it to be an effective desire. Now here you must remember that demand for anything is the amount of it means is the quantity of it that will be bought per unit of time at a given price. Say for example, that when price is rupees 2, at this price you may be willing and you are planning to buy say 10 units of a particular commodity. So here you must remember that when we are defining demand, we are defining demand in the context of time period. That means if you want to buy a particular commodity to meet the demand for a particular day's requirement, accordingly at a given price you will purchase say 10 units of a commodity. But if it is for a week's consumption or for a month's consumption, accordingly you may buy more of the same commodity at the same price. So we can here say that this concept of demand is defined with respect to time period. So from that viewpoint, we can say that the concept of demand is a flow concept, because it is measurable over a period of time. Over a period of time means it is dynamic in nature. It is not a stock concept. Stock concept means it is not a stock variable which is measurable at a particular point of time. But here it is measurable over a specified period of time. So therefore, you must remember here that when we define demand, two important things are important. One is the time element and the price which determines the demand for a particular commodity. Now you must remember, the demand for a particular commodity depends upon a number of factors called as the determinants of demand. Now, the functional relationship that exists between the demand for a commodity and the various factors which determines the demand for a particular commodity represents demand function. So, demand function explains the functional relationship between demand and the various factors on which the demand for a particular commodity depends, like the price of the commodity, the price of related goods, the income of the households, the taste and preferences of the people, the size and composition of population, the distribution of income, propensity to consume, and various other factors. Now let us see how the price of the commodity determines the demand for a commodity. So here we can consider an example wherefrom we can find out that what sort of relationship exists between price and quantity demanded. See here, price of the commodity. You must remember that demand for any commodity X is inversely proportional to its price. Given the other factors determining the demand for the commodity, demand for any commodity X is equal to K into 1 by Px, where K is any constant. Now see, here the demand for a commodity is inversely related to its price. That means that if we assume the factors other than the price of the commodity, that is the price of related goods, the income of the households, the taste and preferences of the people, the size and composition of population, if these factors are held to be constant, then higher the price, lower will be the quantity demanded, and lower the price, higher will be the quantity demanded. Say for example, we are taking a demand schedule. Say this is a demand schedule for commodity X. And here we are measuring price in rupees per unit. And here we are measuring quantity demanded in units. Now suppose when the price is rupee 1, at this price, the consumer is willing to buy 50 units of the commodity. Now, other things remaining the same, if the price rises from rupee 1 to rupees 2, the quantity demanded falls to 40 units. Again, when the price rises to rupees 3, the quantity demanded is 30 units. So, what you observe here? That as the price rises from rupee 1 to rupees 2 and so on, with the rise in price, the quantity demanded falls. And conversely, other things remaining the same, if the price falls from rupees 3 to rupees 2 or P1, what we find that quantity demanded rises from 30 units to 40 units to 50 units, so on. So there exists an inverse relationship between price and quantity demanded. Now, this can be represented with the help of a diagram. Now, suppose this is a graph wherein along y-axis we are measuring price in rupees per unit, and along x-axis we are measuring quantity demanded in units. Now see, here the prices are rupee 1, 2, and this is 3, and this is quantity demanded 10, 20 and 30 respectively. Now see, along y-axis we show the independent variable, and along x-axis we measure the dependent variable. Here the demand for the commodity depends on its price. So demand is dependent variable, and whereas price is the independent variable. Now, in the given demand schedule, we are measuring, we are showing price here in rupees per unit and quantity demanded in units here. Now, observe one thing, that when the price is rupee 1, an individual intends to buy 50 units of a commodity. Now, when the price rises to rupees 2, the quantity demanded is 40 units. When the price rises from 2 to rupees 3, the quantity demanded is 30 units. Now, what we have assumed earlier, that other things remaining the same, means the factors other than the price of the commodity are held as constant. So higher the price, lower is the quantity demanded. Now, if we take the other side, or other way around, if the price falls from rupees 3 to rupees 2, the quantity demanded rises from 30 units to 40 units. And when the price falls from rupees 2 to rupee 1, the quantity demanded increases to 50 units. So therefore, what we find here, that higher the price, lower is the quantity demanded, and lower the price, higher is the quantity demanded. Now, this can be represented graphically. Now, in the given graph or in the given diagram, you find that we are measuring price in rupees per unit along y-axis. And along x-axis, we are measuring quantity demanded expressed in terms of units. Now see, that along y-axis, we represent the independent variable, and whereas along x-axis, we show the dependent variable. Here, the demand for commodity X depends upon the price. So now, if we represent this demand schedule on this graph, what we find, that when the price is rupee 1, at this price, the quantity demanded is 50 units. So here, we are getting a point here. This is the coordinate where at price 1, the quantity demanded is 50 units. Now, when the price rises to rupees 2, the quantity demanded is 40 units. So, here at price 2, the quantity demanded is 40 units. So, we are getting a point here. Now again, when the price rises to rupees 3, the quantity demanded is 30 units. So you are getting a point here. Now, if we join these coordinates of points, so derived, we get the demand curve denoted by DD. This is your demand curve. Now, what does demand curve show? It shows that higher the price, lower is the quantity demanded, and lower the price, higher is the quantity demanded. See here, when the price is rupees 3, at this price, the quantity demanded is how much? 30 units. When the price is 2, the quantity demanded is 40 units. When the price is rupee 1, the quantity demanded is 50 units. So, it expresses an inverse relationship between price and quantity demanded. Now, we are coming to the second point. That is the price of related goods. Now, related goods means what? The goods may be either a substitute good or a complementary good. Now, first of all, you must know that what is substitute good? Substitute goods are those goods which can be consumed with equal ease and satisfaction in place of another. Like for example, tea and coffee. They are substitutable for one another. You get the same, more or less the same level of satisfaction from the consumption of tea in place of coffee. Or if you are offered coffee in place of tea, it gives you more or less the same level of satisfaction. Simply, there are different brands of cold drinks available in the market. Toothpaste, shampoos, there are different brands of shampoos. So they are more or less equi-satisfying commodities and are substitutable for one another. And on the other hand, complementary goods means what? Complementary goods are those goods which are jointly demanded and one cannot be put to use unless the other one is available. Like, for example, car and petrol, then pen and refill, radio and battery. So these all are what? Complementary goods. Now, how the prices of substitute goods affects the demand for other commodities? This can be explained with an example. Let us take up an example here. So we are coming to the price of related goods. So here, what we observe, see, we are taking price of related goods. See, first of all, we have discussed about substitute goods. And here in what I have said, that substitute goods are those goods which can be consumed with equal ease and satisfaction in place of another. Like tea and coffee, or I have said the cold drinks like Coke or Coca-Cola or Thumbs Up or Miranda, etc. Then shampoos, there are various brands of shampoos available in the market like Dove. Then take for example Lux and all, Head and Shoulder. So these all are what? Substitute goods. Now here, see that suppose X and Y are two related goods which are substitutable for one another. Now, if the price of X rises, we can say that it has relatively become costlier to Y. So with the rising price of X, when the price of X rises, the demand for Y will increase because now Y is relatively cheaper to X. Say for example, again I am taking tea and coffee. Suppose if the price of tea increases, with the rise in price of tea, coffee will become relatively cheaper to tea, and as a result, with the rise in price of tea, the demand for coffee will increase. So in this case, what will be the nature of the demand curve? As simple as that, the demand curve will be sloping upward to the right. Here we are taking price of X, and here we are taking quantity demanded of Y. See here, when the price of X is P1, the demand for Y is P1. Now when the price of X rises from OP1 to OP2, X becomes relatively costlier to Y. As a result, with the rising price of X, the demand for Y increases from OQ1 to OQ2. So we can say that demand for Y is directly proportional to price of X. So there is a direct relationship between the two. But on the contrary, in case of complementary goods, as I have earlier said, that complementary goods are those goods which are jointly demanded, and one cannot be put to use unless the other one is available. Like I have taken the example of pen and refill, or car and petrol. In that case, what you find that there exists an inverse relationship between the two. How? Let us see here. So we are taking complementary goods. See here, we are taking again X and Y as two commodities. Now they are complementary to one another. That means one cannot be put to use unless the other one is available. Now if the price of X, if Px increases, naturally Y, which is jointly used with X, with the rise in price of X, the demand for X will fall. Consequently, it will lead to the falling demand for Y. That means the demand for Y will fall. So there exists an inverse relationship between demand for Y and price of X. Demand for Y is inversely related to price of X. So in that case, the demand curve will be downward sloping to the right. See, here we are taking price of X, and here we are taking demand for Y. See here, suppose the price of X is OP. At this price, the quantity demanded is OQ. Now when the price of X rises to OP1, what we observe? With the rising price of X, the demand for X will fall. Consequently, Y, which is used along with X, it will also have a decline in its demand, and we find that its demand reduces from OQ to OQ1. So what sort of relationship exists? Demand for Y is inversely related to the price of X. This is called complementary goods. Now remember one thing, that in case of unrelated goods, unrelated means there is no relationship between the price of one commodity and the demand for the other. Like for example, the price of umbrella and demand for car. There is no relationship. So in that case, they are unrelated goods and the changes in price of one commodity will not affect the demand for the other. So in our next class, we will be discussing the other factors that affects the demand for a particular commodity. Thanks.